entitled Diagnosis, Workup, Investigation Procedures. So this is the first uveitis course. So we're going to start with the first speaker, Dr. Munsef Khairallah. He's going to give us introductions, clinical assessment of posterior uveitis. Professor Munsef Khairallah is a professor of ophthalmology, Faculty of Medicine, University of Monastir. He's the chairman of the Department of Ophthalmology from Tunisia. Professor Munsef.
Thank you very much for the kind invitation. My first talk is on clinical assessment of posterior uveitis. As you all know, posterior uveitis is defined as inflammation of the retina or choroid. Isolated posterior uveitis may be associated with anterior uveitis. This is a serious sight-threatening condition. Clinical assessment is the first and most important step in the diagnostic and management process of posterior uveitis. Proper clinical assessment is very important. It is essential in narrowing the differential diagnosis and providing clues for the final diagnosis of posterior uveitis. Guiding the diagnostic workup, evaluating disease activity and severity, orienting management and monitoring response to treatment. The history is a very important step in the diagnostic approach of posterior uveitis, and history should be comprehensive but guided by ocular finding. Review of medical systems is another important part of the clinical assessment of posterior uveitis. Ocular examination, visual acuity measurement, evaluation of associated anterior segment inflammatory signs, qualitative and quantitative assessment of posterior segment inflammatory signs, vitreous inflammation, and fundus changes. Characterization of posterior uveitis is a very important aspect of the clinical assessment of posterior uveitis. The onset and course of posterior uveitis, the laterality, degree of vitritis, the primary site of inflammation, and the morphological characteristics of posterior uveitis. And all these parameters will provide us important clues for the differential diagnosis of posterior uveitis. Posterior uveitis may be sudden or insidious in onset, acute, monophasic versus acute, recurrent, or chronic. Unilateral posterior uveitis is more often infectious, but some unilateral posterior uveitis may be non-infectious in nature. Bilateral may be infectious or non-infectious. Vitritis, it's important to grade vitreous cells and vitreous haze using grading system, classic or modified grading systems. It is important to keep in mind that some posterior uveitis entities are typically not associated with important vitritis like serpiginous choroiditis. Other entities are usually associated with moderate or severe vitritis like toxoplasmosis. The primary site of inflammation is an important parameter. Retina is the primary site of posterior uveitis inflammation in retinitis or retinochoroiditis. Choroid is the primary site of choroiditis or chorioretinitis. Retinal vessel is the primary site of inflammation in retinal vasculitis and particularly occlusive retinal vasculitis. And finally, optic nerve is the primary site of neuroretinitis. Morphological characteristics, posterior uveitis may be unifocal, multifocal retinitis, retinochoroiditis, or choroiditis, or diffuse choroiditis, or diffuse retinitis. The involvement of posterior pole, periphery, or both posterior pole and periphery. Associated feature like exudative retinal detachment and the presence of associated exudative retinal detachment may occur in any form of posterior uveitis, and this is a typical feature for specific entity like Vogt-Koyanagi-Harada disease, sympathetic ophthalmia, or posterior scleritis. Involvement of the optic nerve may take the form of optic disc edema, optic neuritis, neuroretinitis, optic disc exudate, optic disc granuloma, or sometimes anterior ischemic optic neuropathy. The associated anterior uveitis may be granulomatous, like in sarcoidosis, tuberculosis, iron toxoplasmosis, and chronic VKH, non-granulomatous in Behçet uveitis, hypertensive in entities like iron syndrome or toxoplasmosis. The differential diagnosis based on the morphology of posterior uveitis in patients with unifocal unilateral active lesion associated with old scar with moderate or severe vitritis, this clinical presentation is highly suggestive of, highly suggestive of ocular toxoplasmosis, and we don't need any laboratory investigation to confirm the diagnosis. Toxoplasmosis remain the most likely diagnosis even in the absence of old scar in patients with isolated active lesions without associated old scars. But we have to be aware of atypical clinical presentation of ocular toxoplasmosis, including multifocal bilateral necrotizing retinitis, punctate outer retinopathy, optic neuropathy, and neuroretinitis. These are atypical presentation of ocular toxoplasmosis. In a patient with unilateral white elevated retinal lesion with vitreous traction, this clinical presentation is typical for ocular toxocariasis. In patients with superficial retinitis presenting in the form of retinal infiltrates with diffuse vitritis, retinal vasculitis, with or without associated anterior uveitis, with or without hypopion, in a young patient with or without a history of oral or genital ulcer, this is typical for Behçet uveitis, and we don't need any laboratory investigation to confirm the diagnosis. The diagnosis is purely clinical in nature. Superficial retinal infiltrates may also occur in several infectious conditions, including cat scratch disease, rickettsiosis, syphilis, and other infectious conditions. Necrotizing retinitis, peripheral necrotizing retinitis associated with vasculitis, severe vitritis, anterior uveitis in immune-competent patient is highly suggestive of acute retinal necrosis syndrome. We have to be aware of some conditions that may masquerade as iron syndromes, like Behçet disease, atypical toxoplasmosis, syphilis, primary vitreoretinal lymphoma, and fungal endophthalmitis. All these conditions may mimic acute retinal necrosis syndromes. Necrotizing retinitis associated with immune depression may occur in association with AIDS, CMV retinitis in patients after renal transplantation, or in patients treated with intravitreal corticosteroids, all this situation may lead to CMV retinitis, CMV in immune, in patients with local or systemic immune depression. Differential diagnosis of peripheral multifocal choroiditis include some non-infectious or infectious disease, mainly sarcoidosis, tuberculosis, and syphilis. And in any patient with bilateral peripheral multifocal choroiditis associated with vitritis, snowballs, and granulomatous anterior uveitis, and this is a clinical presentation suggestive of sarcoidosis. Multifocal choroiditis presenting in the form of multifocal set pigeons like choroiditis with mild or moderate vitritis, highly suggestive of tuberculosis. Choroidal granuloma, tuberculosis or sarcoidosis. Tuberculosis and sarcoidosis are the main condition causing choroidal granuloma. And choroidal granuloma, infectious or inflammatory choroidal granuloma, should be differentiated from a primary or secondary choroidal tumor. Diffuse choroiditis associated with exudative retinal detachment, bilateral involvement, young patient, VKH. Diffuse choroiditis with recurrent granulomatous anterior uveitis, this typical aspect of sunset glow fundus, you don't need any laboratory investigation to make a diagnosis of a chronic VKH, even in the absence of extraocular manifestations. Diffuse choroiditis with exudative retinal detachment in a patient with a history of penetrating ocular injury or ocular surgery, sympathetic ophthalmia. Secondary, diffuse choroidal inflammation, unilateral involvement associated with severe ocular pain. This is a clinic, this clinical presentation is typical for posterior sclerites. This particular syphilitic posterior placoid chorioretinopathy, this clinical presentation with a single placoid lesion in the posterior pole, very typical for ocular syphilis. Retinal vasculitis, the presence of multifocal vasculitis, segmental periphlebitis associated with active or inactive choroiditis, sarcoidosis is the most likely diagnosis in such situations. Occlusive retinal vasculitis is common in our region. Two important diagnoses, Behçet disease or tuberculosis. Behçet and tuberculosis are the most important causes of occlusive retinal vasculitis. Frosted branch angiitis, before a diagnosis of idiopathic frosted branch angiitis can be established, we have to exclude infection and non-infection condition as well as malignancy before a diagnosis of frosted branch angiitis can be made. This clinical presentation including arterial aneurysms with hard exudates and retinal vasculitis is very typical for a specific ocular entity called Irvan syndrome. This is a clinical diagnosis. You don't need any laboratory investigation to establish the diagnosis in Irvan syndrome. The term white dot syndromes is a term used to describe a heterogeneous group of inflammatory chorioretinopathy of unknown etiology affecting relatively young, otherwise healthy patients, and classification of white dot syndrome is primarily based on the size and the shape of the chorioretinal lesions and the imaging finding.
But we have to exclude first infectious and non-infectious masqueraders before a diagnosis of idiopathic white dot syndrome can be made. Here are some examples of white dot syndrome, the typical mutes, APP, MPPE, serpiginous idiopathic serpiginous choroiditis. In any patient with serpiginous choroiditis or with AP, MPPE, we have to exclude tuberculosis and syphilis before a diagnosis of white dot syndrome can be made. Other example, the idiopathic multifocal choroiditis, punctate choroidopathy, and presumed ocular histoplasmosis syndromes. Neuroretinitis, the first diagnosis to be considered is cat scratch disease. Neuroretinitis, as you can see, presents in the form of optic disc edema associated with macular partial or complete macular star. Other causes of neuroretinitis include infections like toxoplasmosis, tuberculosis, or rickettsiosis, but we have to exclude other causes of optic disc edema with macular star that are much more common than the true neuroretinitis before a diagnosis of infectious neuroretinitis can be made. So in conclusion, an appropriate approach to the diagnosis of posterior uveitis include a meticulous history-taking and systemic evaluation, a proper analysis of ocular clinical and imaging finding, a guided laboratory evaluation with a limited number of investigations, and this approach can lead to the correct diagnosis in the majority of patients. However, the diagnosis may be challenging in atypical clinical presentation, and we therefore need sometimes an extensive diagnostic workup. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Monsef. We'll open the floor for one or two questions or comments. Any question? I have one question, Dr. Monsef. You mentioned that CMV retinitis, it can happen after intravitreal triamcinolone. So how frequent do you see these cases, and what is the pathophysiology behind it? What is the pathophysiology, and how frequent you see these cases?
I think the most important thing to avoid CMV retinitis in such cases is to not to inject corticosteroids in patient with posterior uveitis before an infectious condition is excluded. So we have to, some patient with, for example, toxoplasmosis misdiagnosed as non-infectious disease, we saw some catastrophic situations. Mm-hmm. I think that we can also see CMV retinitis in patients with Behçet uveitis treated with intravitreal triamcinolone or other corticosteroids. And corticosteroids may cause a local immune depression, and this local immune depression may lead to the development of CMV retinitis. So yeah. It may occur in immune competent patient, but with local immune depression caused by induced by the injection of corticosteroids.
Okay, there is a comment by Professor Abul Asrar.
The statement not to use immunosuppressive therapy before you rule out infection uveitis is also applicable to any type of immunosuppressive therapy. Before you start a patient on immunosuppressive therapy, particularly biologics like infliximab, you have to make sure that you are not dealing with an infectious etiology, regardless of using intravitreal or systemic, because if a patient has tuberculosis uveitis, and you give him infliximab, you will induce Miller tuberculosis. If the patient had toxoplasmosis and you give steroids without broader coverage, with anti-infectious agent, we have seen cases like this, you will induce fulminating, blinding retinitis. So before you start any immunosuppressive therapy, by any route, you have to rule out an infectious cause of uveitis.
Okay, thank you, Prof. So we'll proceed to the second talk, again by Dr. Monsif Khairallah, investigational workup of posterior uveitis. Dr. Monsif.
As I told you, the clinical assessment is the most important step in the diagnostic approach of posterior uveitis. Next presentation, please. Posterior uveitis, as I said before, is a very important form of uveitis. This is a major cause of visual loss involving young patients, and appropriate diagnostic approach is very important, is mandatory to determine the etiology. It is important to determine the cause of uveitis, to exclude an infection, to exclude a masquerade syndrome before giving the patient steroids or immunosuppressive, to treat the patient properly to preserve vision. What should not be done in the diagnostic approach of posterior uveitis? Not paying close attention to the history, taking insufficient clinical examination is an important mistake to be avoided. Missing a clinically evident diagnosis. Failure to recognize a masquerade syndrome. Failure to rule out an infectious cause, and this is a very common mistake, ordering an extensive workup, costly, inefficient, and often misleading. So, what should be done? History, epidemiological data, comprehensive ophthalmic clinical examination, and to follow a tailored approach with ocular imaging, physical examination, and a limited, this is a very important term, a limited number of laboratory investigation guided by the history and clinical findings. This will allow identification of the uveitis in 50 to 70% of our patient with posterior uveitis and proper management of the patient. Our oriented workup is mainly based on the patient age, gender, ethnic and geographic factors, medical and ocular history, and ocular symptoms. And let me remind you again the importance of the clinical characteristics of posterior uveitis as orienting factors or orienting parameters, uni or bilateral involvement, retinitis versus choroiditis versus vasculitis, unifocal or multifocal or diffuse, active, inactive, the presence of vitritis, exudative retinal detachment, associated granulomatous or non-granulomatous anterior uveitis, and the presence or absence of ocular hypertension. All these clinical findings are very, very important in guiding our workup, our differential diagnosis and workup in any patient with posterior uveitis. Let me show you a typical case of ocular toxoplasmosis, unifocal retinochoroiditis associated with old retinochoroidal scar. This is a typical presentation of ocular toxoplasmosis, and again, you don't need any laboratory investigation to confirm the diagnosis in such situation. Toxo remains the most likely diagnosis in unifocal retinochoroiditis without a visible scar, and in such cases, we can order serology for toxoplasmosis as our investigation. We have to exclude or confirm a diagnosis of toxo before performing or ordering other investigation. In a patient with this typical retinochoroidal granuloma with tractional vitreous traction, this typical for toxocariasis, and the only test we will do is serology for toxocariasis. In a young patient with occlusive retinal vasculitis, retinal infiltrates, retinal diffuse retinal vascular leakage in the form this typical pattern of fur-like leakage, the presence of vitreous precipitates associated with extraocular findings like oral ulcers or genital ulcer, a diagnosis of Behçet disease can be easily made without any laboratory investigation. This is a diagnosis. The diagnosis in such cases is based on clinical findings associated with ocular imaging findings. We have the same thing for Vogt-Koyanagi-Harada disease, and this is a typical case of acute VKH, and the diagnosis is again based on clinical and imaging findings. And even in the absence of extraocular manifestation, we have to make the correct diagnosis without the need for any laboratory investigation. Chronic VKH, this is also a clinical diagnosis, the presence of bilateral granulomatous anterior uveitis associated with the sunset glow fundus with or without extraocular manifestations. MUTES is also a clinical diagnosis. The diagnosis imaging will help us make the diagnosis. We don't need laboratory investigation. It's the same for AP and PPE, diagnosis based on clinical and ocular imaging findings. So, I'm sorry. So, in a patient with posterior uveitis, without finding suggestive of a particular etiology, a specific cause, we do what we call a minimal laboratory, first-line minimal laboratory investigation, and this is what we call the minimal laboratory investigation. Okay, so the types of laboratory investigation in patients with posterior uveitis include systemic workup and ocular workup. The body fluid analysis, for example, infectious serology in the blood, it is important to keep in mind that the interpretation of results should be made with caution because false negative and false positive results and the low positive predictive value of serology. This is very important to be kept in mind. HLA typing is also useful in some specific situation, tissue analysis in some cases, and imaging techniques, systemic imaging techniques. Ocular workup include ocular fluid analysis and ocular tissue analysis. Screening for syphilis, this is an important point. We have to, syphilis accounts for only about 1% of uveitis cases, but should be considered in the differential diagnosis of any form of uveitis because syphilis is called the great imitator. So diagnosis of syphilis is usually based on the combination of non-treponemal test, which non-specific test, and a treponemal test that are specific. And in patients with confirmed syphilis, HIV testing is also recommended. Tuberculin skin test helps in the diagnosis of tuberculosis-related uveitis. The test is considered to be positive if, when we have a duration of more than 15 millimeter, but we have to be aware of false negative TST in immune compromised patient, false positive previously vaccinated patient with vaccination with BCG, and as you know, TST does not allow to differentiate between latent and active TB. TST energy is previously vaccinated patient is supportive of the diagnosis of sarcoidosis, as you know. Interferon gamma release assay, mainly the QuantiFERON TB gold, is more sensitive than the tuberculin skin test in the diagnosis of latent TB, higher specificity than TST, particularly in population at low risk for latent TB infection. And this test is not affected by previous treatment with systemic steroids or immune suppressive drugs. The QuantiFERON TB cutoff is one international unit in non-endemic regions and 0.35 in high TB prevalence countries. And in our diagnostic approach to tuberculosis, it is better to combine both tests, TST and QuantiFERON, to make the diagnosis of tuberculosis. A diagnosis of sarcoidosis is a difficult diagnosis, and we start with non-invasive tests to make a diagnosis of definite, presumed, probable or possible sarcoidosis, and in some situation we need some other investigation and some invasive investigation to confirm a diagnosis of sarcoidosis. But we have to start with non-invasive tests and to pay attention to the clinical characteristics of ocular involvement. HLA typing in selected patients with clinical presentation suggestive of birdshot chorioretinitis, the HLA-A29 typing has a high positive predictive value, so this test is very important, is necessary to confirm a diagnosis of birdshot chorioretinitis. However, the positive predictive value of screening patients with posterior or perineal uveitis for HLA-B51 is poor and not recommended for the diagnosis of Behçet disease. Ocular fluid analysis, I think that this would be discussed later, just very short comments. Ocular fluid analysis is necessary for the diagnosis of atypical ocular toxoplasmosis. We don't need to do anterior chamber paracentesis and analysis of ocular fluid in typical toxoplasmosis, but in atypical cases we need to do anterior chamber paracentesis and ocular fluid analysis. Ocular fluid analysis also is necessary in patients with acute retinal necrosis. This is the two most important situation in which ocular fluid analysis is important. A choroidal retinal biopsy, the investigation of last resort in evaluating patient with uveitis, and choroidal or retinal biopsies may be indicated in atypical severe uveitis in which a diagnosis of malignancy of infection is suspected, but we should be aware of complications. And so in conclusion, key points in the diagnostic approach in posterior uveitis include ocular and medical history, a careful systematic clinical examination, oriented investigation. Overuse of the laboratory tests may give misleading results, so do not do extensive workup. Guided workup is the key point in the diagnostic approach of uveitis in general and posterior uveitis in particular. And we should not miss a masquerade syndrome, an infectious cause, but more extensive workup with sometimes invasive procedures can be indicated in severe cases in uveitis worsening under a treatment. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Again, we'll open the floor for one or two questions. Any question or comments? Okay, there is a question here.
Yes,
please. Could you use the phone, please?
Do you recommend the treatment of exacerbation of toxoplasmosis? Chronic toxoplasmosis. There is sometimes there is exacerbation for the disease. Do you recommend treatment of the disease?
Could you repeat the question?
I don't know if my question is clear. It seems not clear.
No, it's not.
There is cases where there is chronic toxoplasmosis, a scar in the retina,
yes.
And you diagnose it as toxoplasmosis,
yes.
Either by clinically or lab.
Yes.
And then after sometimes the same patient came to you with uveitis, posterior uveitis.
Yes.
So, and if you do lab, you will find that there is exacerbation for the toxoplasmosis. The question is, do you treat exacerbation for toxoplasmosis?
Yes, of course.
Sorry?
If you have a recurrence of toxo, we have to treat again?
Not that, no, it is not acute, it's not a new infection.
Chronic.
It's a chronic.
But he has an active lesion now.
Yes.
The lesion itself is no, maybe there is a new focus now.
Yeah, so he has a new focus of retinitis.
Yeah.
We have a new focus retinitis.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because toxoplasmosis is typical acute recurrent disease.
But according to the immunology, he should have a solid immunity from the first infection.
You mean immunocompetent?
No, it's young, it's not immunocompetent.
No, I mean, if he has an active retinitis now,
nah, yes.
On the top of all the scar,
yeah.
Of course, we are going to treat those patients. So he has an active lesion now.
But the problem is, he is coming to you every now and then with the same problem, with the chronic uveitis.
Yeah. Chronicity is not common in toxoplasmosis. We have some chronic severe disease in old patient and immune compromised patient. In immune-competent patient, the disease is usually acute, recurrent, so it takes about 4 to 8 weeks for an acute lesion to heal.
Okay, yeah.
So if you have multiple recurrences, we can consider prophylactic treatment with Bactrim, for example.
Yeah.
Yes, you can consider prophylactic treatment, a long-term use of Bactrim, to decrease the rate of recurrences, yes.
So did you use the as a prophylactic immunosuppressant patient? So if you have immunosuppressant patient, for example, on systemic chemotherapy for whatever reasons, did you keep them on Bactrim for life or for a certain
Not
duration?
For life, but some recent study show that treating a patient with Bactrim for 1 or 2 years can have a good, can give a good outcome for the short, mid, and long term. So it is a controversial issue, but I think that prophylactic treatment can be considered, but not
for life.
Okay,
last comment by Professor Abul Asrar. Thank you.
Just same issue, because I think he meant prophylactic treatment for patients who have multiple scars and they tend to have recurrent attacks. And as Monsef mentioned, prophylactic treatment is proposed by our colleagues from Brazil, that giving cotrimoxazole, which is Bactrim 906 milligram, twice a week.